morning.
Let's just go ahead and go in prayer.
Heavenly Father, we just welcome you here today, Lord. We welcome you, Father. We welcome you, Jesus, Son. We welcome you, Spirit. Just meet us here today. We welcome your presence. We just ask for you to pour out another anointing upon our worship team and as Eddie, as he brings the message to us, God. We just praise you for sending your Son to die on our cross for each one of us. And then sending that Spirit that dwelled in him now dwells in us. Just praise you in this place.
Back to the garden, lead me back to the moment I heard your voice. Take me back to communion, back to the moment I saw your face, and it was all so simple, it was easy to love. No space between us, it was easy to trust.
Let's go back to the beginning. Take me back to the garden. As we commune with God.
Take me back to the garden. Back to the moment I heard your voice. Lead me back to communion, back to the moment I saw your face, and it was all so simple, it was easy to love. No space between us, it was easy to trust. So easy to trust. closer, closer than my skin. You are in.
Closer than my skin.
You are closer, closer than my skin.
Intimacy with Jesus.
You are in the air I'm breathing in.
You're so close, Lord.
You are closer, closer than. Dead things come back to life. to know you are my friend. What a friend, Lord. Closer than a brother. What a friend. Great love hath no man than this. Great love has no man than you, Lord. Great love is not no other than you, Lord. On a hill in Israel, mercy spoke for me. Mercy spoke for me. Mercy spoke for me. It was on Golgotha's stream. His death brought liberty. His death brought liberty. Oh, his death brought liberty.
Let's sing that again.
On a hill in Israel, mercy spoke for me. Mercy spoke for me. Oh, mercy spoke for me. It was on Golgotha's street. His death brought liberty. His death brought liberty. Oh, his death brought liberty. So may I never boast in anything except the cross of Jesus Christ. May I not forget the blood you shed. It is by your death that I am alive. Except the cross of Jesus Christ. May I not forget, I won't forget the blood you shed. It is by your death that I am alive. Because of Christ, I am alive. What a humble sacrifice, love that washed me clean, love that washed me clean, oh, love that washed me clean. What a blessed mystery, his punishment, my peace, his punishment, my peace, oh, his punishment, my peace. What a humble sacrifice, love that washed me clean, love that washed me clean, love that washed me clean. What a blessed mystery, his punishment's my peace, his punishment my peace, oh, his punishment my peace. What a blessed mystery, his punishment, my peace, his punishment, my peace, his punishment, my peace. What a blessed mystery, his punishment, my peace, his punishment, my peace. Oh, his punishment, my peace. So may I never boast in anything except the cross of of Jesus Christ. And may I not forget the blood he shed. It is by his death I am alive. May I never boast in anything except the cross of Jesus Christ. May I not forget, I won't forget the blood you shed. It is by your death I am alive. Because of Christ I am alive. Because of Christ I am. His death brought liberty. His death brought liberty. Oh, his death brought liberty. On a hill in Israel, mercy spoke for me. Mercy spoke for me. Mercy spoke for me. It was on Golgotha's tree. His death brought liberty. His death brought liberty. Oh, his death brought liberty. On a hill in Israel, mercy spoke for me. Mercy spoke for me. Oh, mercy spoke for me. And it was on Golgotha's tree. His death brought liberty. His death brought liberty. Oh, his death brought liberty. May I never boast in anything except the cross of Jesus Christ.
Spilling the wine of your blood. Thank you.
bread in your body, distilling the wine of your blood. Thank you, oh, my heart will sing forever.
Oh, the cross, what you've done, it was more than enough. Thank you. take this world and give me all I want, Jesus. Oh, I want Him. Oh, only Jesus. Take this world and give me. shall rise to me. God in three persons, blessed Trinity. Casting down their golden crowns around the glassy sea, cherubim and seraphim, they're all falling down. Songs shall rise to
God in three persons, the Blessed Trinity.
I like singing about the Trinity. I love the Father. He says to come to the Father when we pray, our Father. But that also that Jesus came to reveal who God is to us. He is the image of the invisible God. And then we embrace the Holy Spirit, for the Holy Spirit points to us what truth is. Who Jesus is, what Jesus came to do, and what he enables and empowers us to do. That's why we continue with this series. It's going to be longer than I thought, and because of just the digging has caused a thirst in my own heart. I heard someone say it so well, who, very educated, very knowledgeable man by the name of Ken Fish, Princeton graduate, who had this hunger to worship Jesus and to see his face and to acknowledge and praise him, but also had this hunger and thirst for that same Jesus to express himself in our world. He began to question what is and what has changed. And this very, very intelligent man came down to this one idea. Regardless of what anybody else said, he could not move away from this one verse. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. That is the God that we serve. That is the God who is still alive. We have become accustomed to a God who's only spoken, but a God who doesn't speak. He doesn't speak outside of what he's already spoken. Because you can always test what God says when he's speaking against what he's already spoken. So we're going to continue with this series on the manifestation of the Holy Spirit, reading first in 1 Corinthians 12, verses 8 through 10. It says this: "For to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, and to another the word of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. And to another, gifts of healing by the one Spirit. And to another, the effecting of miracles. And to another, prophecy. And to another, the distinguishing or discerning of spirits. To another, various kinds of tongues. And to another, the interpretation of tongues. For our study, I've split these into three categories. First, the gracelets, and that's what they are, gracelets, grace gifts. Charismata, charis meaning grace. You don't earn gifts, you receive them. But the gracelets of discernment are what represent the eyes of God, the gracelets of power, the hand of God, and the gracelets of speech, the mouth of God. So we're going to talk about the gracelets of discernment, the eyes of God. It's expressed in three of these manifestations. One, the word of wisdom. 2, word of knowledge, and 3, the Sermon of Spirits. All of these gifts of supernatural insight, not natural. Word of wisdom, definition. It's an utterance inspired by God and spoken by an individual. If you go to 1 Kings 3, 16 through 8, 28, it's a little longer story, but all of you know it. There was these two ladies who had 2 sons, and one of the sons died of suffocation. Well, both of the mothers claimed the child that was remaining to be their own. So they brought the child to Solomon. And he said these words, "Bring me a sword, divide the child in 2 and give half to one and half to the other." Instead of solving the dispute, he said, "Here's how we'll decide." Of course, the real mother was not willing to give up her child. So she said, "No, don't do that. Save the child." And he gave the child back to the mother, the real mother. Old Testament illustration. New Testament illustration, word of wisdom in Matthew 22, 15 through 22. I neither listed these verses, neither. But they came to Jesus. They were trying to trick him, like they were always trying to trick him, drag him into something. And anyway, they asked the question, is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Because they wanted him to say not. but Jesus said, "Okay, show me this. Look at the coin. Whose likeness do you see on the coin?" And of course, they said, "Well, we see Caesar's." Jesus said then, "Render therefore to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's." Which we render a lot to Caesar. But Jesus had a way of answering that statement with the word of wisdom. Not because the Holy Spirit just fell on him and remained. You see in the scripture that Jesus is referred to the Son of God, but also to the Son of Man. Many people think that Jesus operated as the Son of God, and that's why he did supernatural things. I'm convinced that Jesus operated in the same way that we are to operate, by the gifting and the power of the Holy Spirit. Jesus said this about himself, "I only do what I see the Father doing. I don't initiate anything. So I tune in to what God's doing and I get in on that and I bless that." If you remember, he came back from the wilderness and said that Jesus came back and he was full of the Holy Spirit. So Jesus would have times when the Holy Spirit would rest on him and come on him for a certain time, a certain point, a certain reason to minister to others. That has not changed. You can explain the Holy Spirit away and his gifts if you want to be crafty enough with scripture. And many do. But you have to leave out a lot of stuff to get to that conclusion. But the end result was that they marveled at the wisdom of Jesus. And you often will hear after Jesus speaks, they walk away and they've got nothing to say because they were marveling at what he would have to say. He was speaking wisdom that was given to him from God. So, where would you expect a word of wisdom? Well, in any situation which requires problem solving. You say, "Well, how would I know? How do I get in on this?" Well, I'm just talking about in counseling, in talking to people, there's times you need something that you don't know. You need wisdom from God. In the proclamation of the word, you need a word of wisdom often. How does the word of wisdom come? Well, it comes in a way where you see in a revelatory way what is being said or done from God's perspective, so that you hear from heaven And wisdom comes in such a way that it simplifies things, this word of wisdom, and will bring it down to a singular point and focus. It takes the complex and turns it into simplicity. Sometimes it'll be in a mind's eye picture. You just see something in your mind and you go, okay, I'm seeing this in my mind. I'm thinking this in my mind. Is that God? Oftentimes it is. When something comes to you, and I'll give you the example in a minute, but it also may come through a prophetic utterance. Now, you may not think that you're prophesying when you speak a word of wisdom, but oftentimes you are. And almost all, I'll say almost always, comes in exchange, which is happening at the time. I'm going to go back to a simple example. We went out and we've looked at two buildings. We came back and we pulled up into Alan Terry's driveway, and it was the four of us, Gretchen and I and Alan Terry. And Terry said, I really just sense the Lord saying, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. I'm standing outside my, inside my house looking out the window, and I'm planting, trying to grow a lawn. And you know, you can become so concerned about what is or what isn't happening, or how do you make something happen, or how do you make something grow, it actually takes about 2 years to grow in a zoysia lawn. That is, if you take it care of it correctly. You have to prepare the soil. You have to smooth it out. You have to spread the seed. You have to spread the right amount of seed. You have to mow it to an inch and a half so that the clover and other weeds will allow the sun to get to the seed. And I'm going out and I'm looking, and I can see smaller than a dime in several places, little zoysia seeds that are germinating after 28 days. And as I stood there, Gretchen said, you're awful quiet today. You know, but what's wrong? And I said, nothing's wrong. I just got still enough to hear God's voice. And he said that Jesus' church would grow much like zoysia. You say, well, right, yeah. When I first planted the lawn, the seeds started to come out. I said, oh man, this is, you see green. I thought, good grief, we're onto something here. Here we go. I went out there and looked real close, and it was clover. And I really thought I was onto something, but I wasn't. A lot of people can grow clover. But then, reading and knowing that it would take 28 days for zoysia to be still be smaller than a dime was a comfort to me. Not just when it comes to growing a lawn, but when it comes to Jesus' church. We will look back to this time and this day and this moment, and you'll go, man, remember when the Lord said we were going to be like zoysia? And to seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. He's going to take care of us. Because we're going to magnify Jesus. And then he's going to take care of it. And we're going to listen as we go. But I said it almost always occurs in the exchange, which is happening at the time. A lot of times when you have a big decision to make, do you ever say, you know what, I'm going to sleep on that. Or I'm going to think about this over the weekend. And I'm going to come back to it. Just taking the time and getting quiet. regardless of which of these gracelets we're talking about, there does need to be a time of quiet, a time of solitude, a time where you can tune in and get quiet enough to hear God's voice. How can that be initiated? What can we do to open ourselves up to that? Here's what I would say. Like, if somebody tells me a dream that they've had, I will get real quiet. And I'll just begin to try and listen for God's voice. That doesn't have to be something that you just do to dial down to tune in. You can dial down to tune in at any point in time and in any exchange. Do you need a word of wisdom in your business? Do you need a word of wisdom in how to handle employees? Word of wisdom in how to talk to a family member about something that they may not really want to talk about. God's always willing to speak. He even says so in James. He says, you know what? If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask, and I'll give it to you. So I would hate to see a word of wisdom be something that only is contained to a church setting, but that our entire lives are spent more tuning in to the voice of the Lord. For me, and I don't, any of these manifestations, I believe that any person can operate in. They're not for one person. They're not for one gifted person. They're for everybody at any time. So when you need something, it's not like you are the guy, you're a laborer in construction and you're in the union and the only thing you can do is turn wrenches. When it comes to the Holy Spirit, He has all these tools. God has all these tools. And if you need this, God will give you this. Maybe it's a word of wisdom at the time. Word of knowledge. Word of knowledge is an utterance inspired by God, spoken by an individual. Give you a few examples. One, the woman at the well, John 14:17-18. The woman at the well came and Jesus was there and let his disciples go on, and she came at that time of day. But Jesus ends up asking her about her husband. She said, the woman answered and said, I have no husband. Jesus said to her, you have correctly said, I have no husband. For you have had five husbands, and the one whom you now have is not your husband. This you have said truly, I have no husband. Jesus didn't go and look up this lady's history to find out. God spoke to Jesus through the power of the Holy Spirit, got to this woman's heart, revealed who she was, and her answer was, you're a prophet. You should know that about me. In our day and time, people get amped up about that if somebody has a word of knowledge. Like, oh, yeah, that's a big deal, It's not a big deal. It's a normal thing for God to speak and say something that you do not know in order that he can have his way. Another one is Matthew 9:2-4. Says, and they brought to him a paralytic lying on a bed. I love this story. This is Jesus. Jesus, seeing their faith, Jesus said to the paralytic, take courage, son, your sins are forgiven. And some of the scribes said to themselves, this fellow blasphemes. And Jesus, knowing their thoughts, said, why are you thinking evil in your heart? Again, do you know a thought? Sometimes you do. Sometimes you know what someone's thinking. Sometimes you may, even as you listen to their words. Al and I were in an exchange with another person. And as a person spoke, I knew what his thoughts were with each sentence that he was saying and what his motive and the motive of his heart was. And Al would say the same. And we could go back and then revisit that and talk at a separate time and say, you know what, that's not God. That was not the Lord. This motive is wrong. This motive is off. But I like this part too here. It says, and you need to think about this when it comes to other people. These four men bring in this paralytic. And it says, Jesus seeing whose faith? Their faith. Not the man who was sick. The men who brought the man to Jesus. And so when we are those people who will gather around someone in the name of Jesus and pray for them, Jesus, the Father, can still see faith. And so can we. I'm looking forward to talking about that manifestation. But I love the fact that you've always heard, and it's been very constant in the faith world, that if you don't get healed, it's because you didn't have enough faith. It says nothing about the paralytic's faith. It says something about the people who carried him in. Verse 5 goes on to say, which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven, or to say, get up and walk? But so that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, then he said to the paralytic, get up, pick up your bed, and go home. And he got up and went home. Word of wisdom. In the middle of word of knowledge. Jesus seeing their faith. Jesus hearing their thoughts. Jesus saying this word of wisdom. Now you think of this. Do you have any trouble believing that when you ask Jesus to forgive your sins, he's going to say, nope, not today. That ground's been fought for. Healing? Not as much. The supernatural? Not as much. People have kind of given up that fight. And here Jesus says, you know what? I can say one or the other. I can say get up, or I can say your sins are forgiven. Either one, just as easy. He's making a statement about salvation, and he's making a statement about God's powerful hand all at the same time. John 4:45. There's a royal official. He's got a son who is on the brink of death. And it says that the royal official said to him, Jesus, sir, come down before my child dies. Jesus said to him, go, your son lives. The man believed the word that Jesus spoke to him and started off. And as he was now going down, his slaves met him, a man of great means, saying that his son was living. So he inquired of them the hour when he began to get better. Then they said to him, yesterday at the seventh hour, the fever left him. So the father knew it was at that hour in which Jesus said to him, your son lives. And he himself believed, and his whole household. I was walking across the yard in the evenings, get enough shade walking down this fence row, that's a good time to walk and get some steps in. And it was shortly after our last time we met. We were talking about the manifestation of the Holy Spirit. And the Lord just spoke this to my spirit, that a lot of people are not going to care about the manifestation of the Spirit until they're in need. And this man's son's life is on the line. Now he cares whether God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. That circumstances themselves will put you in a place to say, God, if you're there, if you're real, if you're here, if you're the same, I need you to move. I need you to act. I need you to manifest in my life. A need often draws people to that point of saying, I need God. If God doesn't move, I'm in trouble. If God doesn't act, I'm in trouble. So, also you gotta look at this is that, what's the outcome of this? Just that the man's son lives? No. God moved, God acted. Because God moved and God acted, that man believed and his whole household believed. that the move of the Holy Spirit will often lead people to embrace Jesus Christ as their Savior. And we need to remember that. So often do people operate and see a healing occur, that they will pause and stop a service and take an offering. But we miss it so bad because we turn it into something of a person being special instead of Jesus, the Holy Spirit, moving and touching lives. And the Holy Spirit, same Holy Spirit that healed that son, now brought this family to Jesus. How does the word of knowledge come? Well, you can just come with the picture in your mind. You see a picture. Or just an inner knowing. I just know that's God. I hear him. Or an analogy. Timmy was telling me a dream. And I thought about, and it just came to mind, two different scenes from a movie that were both describing the dream that he had. That is a word of knowledge. A picture of written word. I've seen pictures of written words before. Simple thing, but I think anybody can, but you got to be open to the fact that God's still doing that. I saw written on a wall once the word glory, and it gave comfort to my heart. I didn't know what all it meant, but I know from that time till this, I still hang on to that, that God wants us to give him glory. Not for us to try and take credit for something that only God can do. So, it can also come as a pain in your body. I've had this, and the reason I tell you these things is because I want you to be able to recognize as well. We were in the meeting here, and I've got a severe headache and went away. That was a word of knowledge. It was for a person in that room. The people in that room were what I would call ungifted, unfamiliar with that kind of move of God. And I kept the word to myself, believing that giving that word in that setting would only bring trouble. But I could have not been discerning correctly. Maybe I should have given that word. But oftentimes you may have that exact pain in your body that's somebody else's, and it's not for you. It comes on, you go, where'd that come from? Well, there's a place it comes from. God is gifting. Or a spontaneous utterance which comes without your volition. The thing that you speak something that bypasses your mind and comes out of your mouth. That happens a lot to a lot of us. It's called speaking without thinking. No filter. No, not a soul in this room. But where would you use a word of knowledge? Well, during any request for prayer, regardless of the location. That you'd be listening for the Holy Spirit, listening for what God wants to do. Before, during, or after praying for someone to be healed, at any time of quiet contemplation. Discerning of spirits. The supernatural capacity to judge from a spiritual insight whether the spirit operating has a source that is human, demonic, or divine. It is a supernatural perception from the spiritual realm for the purpose of determining the source of spiritual activity. Discerning of spirits often operates alongside other gifts. When I said a while ago the word of knowledge, I need a discernment whether should I speak this? Should I act on this? So I need to discern during that moment, during that time. Because I often say there's a right time, a right place, and a right way to say the right thing. And sometimes just because you hear a word doesn't mean you're supposed to say that word at that point in time. We need discernment as to when the right time is. So the Bible gives us this gift of discernment, and it gives it to the church. I'll read you two verses, 1 Thessalonians 5:19 through 21. Do not quench the Spirit. Do not despise prophetic utterances, but examine everything carefully. Hold fast to that which is good. So he's saying, don't quench your spirit. Pay attention to what's being prophesied. How do you do that? Examine it. Look at it. Hold fast to that which is good. So when a prophetic word would be given, the thing that I've told my own children when they went away to school, and they were a part of supernatural schools. Worship was common, healing was common, gifts were common. And I said, I want you to be discerning, only I said it like this. I want you to treat what you hear like eating fish is you just eat the fish, you don't have to eat the bone. Because some words are going to be partially true, partially from God, maybe partially from that person, or it could be partially from hell. Discerning which is a gift that God gives for us to control the abuse of prophecy, to measure the word against the word. It says this in 1 John 4:1-3. Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. By this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit, now he's talking about there are spirits of light, there are spirits of darkness. Knowing the difference is huge. That's why it says so many times in the scripture, and I'm not sure how many times it says, do not be deceived. Do not be deceived. In order to know whether something's from God or not, there needs to be some ability to discern what spirit it's from. Because there can be something that's very true that can be from a human spirit, or there can be that one thing that God's speaking, and you hear it, and you go, okay, I think I really heard God. That meant something to me. That did not. That I'm going to reject. I've had people pray for me and be right. I've had people pray for me and be completely wrong. And you know what my answer was? Because I was discerning. I'm just not going to accept something just because somebody says it and the power of the Holy Spirit's there. And two different times I can think of right now in prayer that somebody came and they gave me this word. One, I said, I'm sorry, you know, that's from you. That's not from God. I had a person stop by my office and tell me how I was going to go over to another country and be a missionary. Well, God forgot to tell me that. And he didn't tell that guy that either. He was just wrong. I didn't tell him any different. I just nodded my head and let him go on. But am I supposed to, just because somebody says something, am I supposed to act for that when they say, well, the Lord told me? No, you're supposed to discern whether the Lord told you or not. So we are not to be blind. This is why the spiritual gifting comes and gets rejected oftentimes, because people don't want the other. Well, you have to take a chance of having the other to have the real. It's just part of it. But it's up to us to discern whether or not it is from God. Every spirit, by this you will know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. And every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, of which you've heard that it's coming, and now it is already in the world. What you and I do with Jesus Christ, what we believe about Jesus Christ, that he came in the flesh, God in the flesh, Emmanuel, God among us. That's what we proclaim. We proclaim that in our teaching. We proclaim that in our worship. That's a big part of who we are, is confessing who Jesus Christ is. Now, I have in fact been accused of being of this, of another kingdom, of the kingdom of darkness. The devil's not going to exalt Jesus. He's just not into that. He's into tearing Jesus down. He's into destroying Jesus' works. But Jesus said, no, I came to destroy the works of the devil. And one of the ways that you destroy the works of the devil is to confess, like we did in our worship this morning, the exaltation of Jesus, the cross of Christ, the blood that he shed. We go back to Jesus. And you find me somebody who's exalting Jesus, and I'm going to tell you this much, they are from God. They're not from the kingdom of darkness. The devil's least interested in exalting Jesus. He's only interested in exalting himself. That's why he got his butt kicked out of heaven, and a third of the angels along with him, because of the pride that came with that. That's the Antichrist. So, illustrations, 1 Samuel 16:12 through 13. King Saul, well, it was Samuel who was looking for who would be the king of Israel. And they brought in all of David's brothers. And the Lord spoke to Samuel and said, you know, when you see this guy, don't look on the person. Because God doesn't look on a man's outward appearance, but look at the heart. So as they would bring these men in, Samuel would say, no, not that one either. Okay, we're all done. Who? You got any more? So what they did, so they went and found Jesus, David, of the line of the tribe of Judah. David, let's get him right. They didn't go get Jesus. Says, so he went and brought him in. Now he was ruddy, with beautiful eyes and a handsome appearance. And the Lord said, arise, anoint him, for this is he. Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. And the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. You would think that God could just anoint David, not go through all this, that the prophet Samuel wouldn't take the horn of oil and have to anoint Jesus, and then the Spirit of the Lord come upon him mightily from that day forward, David. But God sought to do it that way. I think from that day forward, David would look back and say, I remember when the Spirit of the Lord came upon me mightily and it changed the course of my life. So, now, the story gets better. It says in verse 14, now the Spirit of the Lord departed from Paul, and an evil spirit from the Lord terrorized him. Did I say Paul? Yeah, Saul. The Spirit of the Lord didn't depart from Paul. And an evil spirit from the Lord terrorized him. Saul's servants then said to him, behold, now an evil spirit from God is terrorizing you. That could cause some people some trouble. God allowed an evil spirit to terrorize a man. The answer to that question is yes, he did. Yes, he did. So, verse 23. This is so intriguing. So it came about whenever the evil spirit from God came to Saul, David would take the harp and play it with his hand. And Saul would be refreshed and be well, and the evil spirit would depart from him. If you're in a mess, if you're in a time where you're battling, you're in a time of warfare, where the kingdoms collide, One of your safest places is in the presence of God, worshiping Jesus. I love, there's a song that's, the name of it, Surrounded. And I got in my car and left the basketball game, and that song was playing. And it goes like this: it may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Sometimes we need that reminder that God is closer than our skin, that he is in the air that we're breathing in, and that that spirit that gives life is upon us. And what was a down moment where I was being defeated in my mind, instead, I was not being defeated because I was surrounded. The battle is not mine. The battle belongs to the Lord. And if I will just worship him and be in his presence and recognize who he is, that God will take care of that. So important to have spirit-led, spirit-anointed worship. Because the spirit of darkness does not like the spirit of light. So, Luke 11:27. Jesus was talking, and I'd tell you the story, but it's longer than you might want to hear. So anyway, it says, while Jesus was saying these things, one of the women in the crowd raised her voice and said to him, blessed is the womb that bore you and the breast at which you nursed. This woman recognized Jesus was the Son of God. And she spoke this out. She discerned that Jesus, who Jesus was, that he came to earth. Again, discernment. Matthew 16:17-20. Jesus was talking to his disciples, and he said to them, you know, who do people say that I am? Then he gets down to this question, who do you say that I am? Simon Peter answered, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus said to him, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, because flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. As far as I know, everybody that's in this room has heard and discerned that very thing. That Jesus Christ is who he said he was. He is who he said he was. And he will be who he's going to be. But we met him at a point in time and recognized that he is the Son of God. The same spirit of discernment that rested upon Peter that day has rested upon every one of us at some point in time to where we recognize that Jesus is the Christ. You don't know that by flesh and blood. You only know that because God spoke that to you, made Jesus real, Jesus alive, and made you desire Jesus. It says that there are none who seeks for him. You weren't, if you were looking for God and found him, I don't know. You may have been looking for something, but God found you and gave you a desire for him. That's the big deal. We can have a lot of deals happen, but that is the biggest one. So, but we go on and read down a little bit further. In verse 21, it says, from that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised up on the third day. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, Lord, God forbid it, Lord. This shall not happen to you. But he turned to Peter and said, get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you're not setting your mind on God's interest, but man's. The same guy that had the revelation of who Jesus was now is trying to stop Jesus from doing what Jesus came to do. And Jesus looks at Peter and says, hey, Satan, get back here. He discerned that there was this man who recognized him but did not recognize the path that he had to take and why he came. And the devil was using Peter to try and dissuade Jesus from doing what he came to do. Then in verse 24, it says, when the Pharisees heard this, they said, because he's talking about, he moves on, he's talking about they had cast out demons. I'll read that part in a minute. Get behind me, Satan. You're a stumbling block. Can we say that in the name of Jesus? Get behind me, Satan. Don't stand in my path. The enemy wants to hold every person in their past. If he can't, he'll do everything he can to hold us in our past so that we don't see our future in Christ. He's always working to do that. If he wants to remind you, you're no good, you're not worthy, you're not capable, you've done this or you've done that to keep you, that's a lie straight from hell. Recognize it as that and put it in its place. Another story, Matthew says, then a demon-possessed man who was blind and mute was brought to Jesus, and he healed him. A demon-possessed man, blind and mute, so that the mute, Jesus healed him so that the mute man spoke and saw. All the crowds were amazed and were saying, this man cannot be the son of David, can he? So, in healing, we see a man who's blind and mute. Guess what's behind that sickness? Jesus didn't say, I'm going to heal you. He's got to deal with the demonic. The man possessed by an evil spirit. If we suppose that we are going to step into the supernatural realm and not need to be able to discern between light and darkness, we're wrong. We're going to have to at all times. We're going to have to discern. And sometimes when you're praying for someone who's sick, you may have to deal with the demonic world. So, verse 24, but when the Pharisees heard this, they said, this man cast out demons only by Beelzebul, the ruler of the demons. Again, demons don't cast out demons. Darkness doesn't work to get rid of darkness. Light works to get rid of darkness. So, and here's Jesus. And knowing their thoughts, Jesus said to them, how do you know their thoughts? God spoke to him. Any kingdom divided against itself is laid waste. Or any city or house divided against itself will not stand. So, we have to recognize who our enemy is. We have to recognize where evil comes from. And the attacks that come against us that are evil, they come from the evil one who is set to kill, steal, and destroy from us. Here's what Jesus said to this group of people. But if I cast out demons by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. So here's Jesus casting out spirits. What does he say? When I cast them out in the name of Jesus, what happens? The rule of God has come. The kingdom of God has come upon you. So when Jesus said, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, for us to pray that way, he's saying to his disciples, if you go somewhere and you cast out demons, tell them the kingdom's come near them. And he's saying that of himself. If I cast out demons, it's because the kingdom came upon me. So here's Paul, Acts 16, in the last verse we'll look at. It happens as we were going to the place of prayer, a slave girl having a spirit of divination met us, who was bringing her masters much profit by fortune telling. Following after Paul and us, she kept crying out, saying, these men are bondservants of the Most High God who are proclaiming to you the way of salvation. That is what Paul was doing. The demonic spirit couldn't handle that. And the demonic spirit, through this lady, with the spirit of divination, spoke truth about who Jesus was. So, she continued doing this for many days. But Paul was greatly annoyed. I don't know why he waited several days to get, many days to get greatly annoyed, but he did. evidently just the Spirit of God came on him at that time and said, deal with this. That's enough out of the kingdom of darkness. And he turned and said to the Spirit, not to the person, I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And it came out at that very moment. If you have never been in a place where a demon manifested, darkness manifested, I've seen where people became very much afraid. But I've also seen the light click on from people after a little bit, seeing that and go, ooh, there's the devil. That is a demonic realm. If you do not know who you are in Christ, you might have some fear toward the demonic. Well, God hasn't given us a spirit of fear. We're not to operate in any fear regarding darkness. They've given us power, love, and a sound mind. So that, faced with any demonic situation, we are already standing in the one who has already won, who whooped the devil by his blood, and we stand in that strength and in that authority. He has given us authority, as he did the 10, as he did the 70, to cast out demons and to heal diseases. Power by the Holy Spirit, authority by speaking in the name of Jesus. So, but they grabbed Paul and Silas, I think it was, and they threw them in jail for it. which goes to tell you one thing. I mean, this lady made a lot of money, it said. So they took Paul and Silas to the chief magistrates, and the chief magistrates took them to the authorities and had them thrown in jail. And they warned them not to speak of this Jesus. Of course, they couldn't shut him up. Arena of use, during the use of any verbal gift. Again, word of wisdom, word of knowledge, prophecy. You need discernment to know. When you have a disagreement between parties, none of us have ever had disagreements, but sometimes when we do, we need to tune in to the word, to the voice of the Lord, to discern God's voice in the middle of it. A conflict existing in a ministry setting, a meeting, or over a group of people. I think one of them, for me, that's really important for me to discern is to see and recognize and discern a spirit of religion. I have seen a spirit of religion again and again. And the more that I see it, it's kind of like if you're let's say you collect coins, you see the real thing enough, you recognize what's counterfeit. And that's how they train people to recognize whether a bill is counterfeit, is they have them look at the real thing so often so they know the difference. There's a spirit of religion that's heavy, heavy, heavy over the churches in our community. I've went and I've looked and I've tried to watch as many as I can online and see what's going on. And I don't see Jesus being exalted in a lot of places. They've lost their focus. They're doing the same things that they did when I was a kid. Nothing's changed. The church hasn't changed. The music hasn't changed. The focus hasn't changed. And they point people and say, come to the church. Come to the church. It's all about this church. You being here and being used of God, and our numbers growing, and us getting bigger. It is not about any of that. It's about the kingdom. Everywhere we go, it's about us having Jesus manifest in our lives. It's about us taking the time to tune in and listen for his voice in every setting. You wouldn't know when Blaine leads worship that Blaine grew up what most people would consider very shy. But the thing that Blaine has always done, is while other people were talking, Blaine wasn't. And when we're in the middle of a conflict or a scrape, one of the best things we can do sometimes is just keep our mouth shut. Just listen for the voice of the Lord. I could tell a story about this, but it was that kind of situation. I was put under fire, so to speak, by someone. And I just nodded my head, let them say what they were going to say. 2 days later, I came back and said, you know what? You're wrong about this, 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 and this. You should have done this, this, and this instead. Because I took the time to discern and listen. And again, it's that getting quiet enough to hear the voice of the Lord and listening and expecting for Him to speak. But anyway, arena of use. We already talked about that. A meeting, a setting, ministry setting. You could be in a board meeting and the devil take over. I've seen that happen. And I'm not just talking about church. I'm talking about school, anywhere. I mean, you can just see that this kingdom of darkness starts having its way and making accusations. And that's how the devil works. He accuses, whether it's true or not. How does it come? You might see a word written over someone's face that just points to darkness. Or maybe like a shadow or a dark patch on someone's mind. Or maybe even a part of their body. You say, well, you're looking for darkness. No, God wants to show you darkness. That darkness may be that you see a place of darkness on someone's lower back, or you see a place of darkness on someone's mind. The enemy works fiercely on our minds. Or you might see a shape superimposed over the portion of the anatomy that if you were to color it out, you might see that it was the shape of an organ. And here's one of the things that I think that might be very, very helpful for all of us, is that when the glory of God comes and when the Spirit of God rests on people, there is often a heat associated with it. There are three ways that I personally try to tune in to what the Spirit of God is saying and doing. One, by extending my hands and just being open. Taking a moment, just allowing the Spirit to move, not to get in a hurry. Two, by quietly speaking in tongues. For some reason, you get tuned into the spiritual realm by speaking in tongues. And if you do not have and express that gift, that doesn't mean that you do not have the Holy Spirit. Because any one of these all fall in the same category. But I have looked out on people from a ministry setting. I've done it here. And you see sometimes that the Spirit of God is resting on a person. And you see this glow to their face. And it can be natural and it can be supernatural. But you sense that the presence of God is on this person. What He's doing, you're not sure. And maybe that's when you pause and reflect and thank God, what are You doing in that person's life? I see You working on that person. So oftentimes, here's where the invitation in most churches work. The invitation is given to people, not to the Lord. The invitation is not given to the Spirit of God to come and rest upon His people. We know when Jesus said, I only do what I see the Father doing, He's seeing something. So when you pray for people, I would encourage you to pray with your eyes open. And we'll talk about a healing model in another time, because we're running long on time. But that we can see oftentimes that the Spirit of God has fallen on someone through very natural means as well as supernatural means. That glow and glisten can be just that person beginning to perspire because the heat of the Lord is upon them. And that's also something else you can recognize. My chest will get heavy in the presence of God when God really comes in power. It's kind of like, that's my tuning fork, I guess. But also my hands will often get as hot. I mean like red fire hot. I don't say these things to say to you, okay, I'm all that. I say these things because this is what I know of when God has used me to pray for and to minister to others in the power of the Spirit and not because of Eddie's desire to see something happen. I want God involved. I want to bless what he's doing. Gretchen's dad and I, along with several other men that I know, have often prayed with people and prayed for healing and end up having to cast out demons. And her dad carries this authority in the spiritual realm to speak to the spirits of darkness at a level that that most people don't. But he and I would often team up together and we would pray for people together. And he would be that person wielding the authority and speaking to that spirit. And I would be that person was watching for the Spirit of God move and blessing what God was doing in that person. And the combination of the two of us ministering together, people were being freed. People were being healed. When we go back to this person with the spirit of divination, one of the things that I would encourage everyone to do, and we've always done this, I have nothing to do with Ouija boards. I have nothing to do with Dungeons and Dragons. I have nothing to do with opening myself up to the spiritual world of darkness, because it says, do not give the devil a foothold in your life. When you open yourself up to the spiritual world of wickedness, you are asking for more than what you may think you're asking for. And so for every person who's celebrating, one of the groups I really liked, AC/DC, sorry. I like rock and roll. Just because you're a Bible teacher doesn't mean you have to stop liking rock and roll. But I'm not singing Highway to Hell. I'm grieved by people who are on the Highway to Hell instead. I'm not going to sing or listen to Hell's bells and celebrate darkness. I'm not going to open myself up to that. And one of the best things we can do is never step into those paths. One of the better things that we can do is absorb ourselves, our lives, in the worship of Jesus and the Spirit of God. Amen? All right. So, whereas the graceless of discernment have to do with insight, seeing God's perspective, the graceless of power have to do with the hand of God, faith, gifts of healing, the effects of miracles, which is what we're going to talk about next time. And I can't wait to have that conversation. It's going to be a good one. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your blessing. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for your power. And we invite you even here, even now, as you have been this morning, to rest upon us, but not just to rest upon us. For any person who cues into this, may they pause and reflect. May they pause and give the Holy Spirit a minute to fill them, to anoint them, to speak to them, to bless them with his presence. So, Father, we thank you that you have blessed us with your presence. And your presence is not only within us, but upon us. Upon us to do the works of Jesus in our generation. And may it be that you reveal yourself in power in our lives during this time. And Lord, we pray that it would happen not just at Jesus Church, but in every church. that there may be an openness to revival. There may be an openness to the fire of God falling. There may be an openness to an anointing that comes from heaven, that our God, who was, is, and is to come, who has never changed and will not change, will be revealed to us in a powerful, in a beautiful way. And may we at every turn exalt Jesus Christ and Him alone, and thank Him for giving gifts to men and women, that we might see the Holy Spirit revealed, manifested in our world today and in our lives. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.